Everybody, welcome to this matchup between Penn State and Ryerson University. This is going to be a big uLol match today as it's the first round of the playoffs, and it is single elimination. I believe best of three. I actually didn't have time to ask, but I believe it's going to be a best of three series here between Ryerson and Penn State. Ryerson's going to be on the blue side. Penn State's on the red side. I think that was determined because Ryerson is the higher seed right now, but I'm going to be joined later on by Brian Liu. He's actually going to be the coach for Penn State, so he's in the drafting phase with them right now, so he's going to join me after the drafting process. So, as we see this, Zed, LeBlanc, Jin, Kazakhspan, the LeBlanc and the Kazakhspan, no surprise there. They're both strong picks right now, extremely strong ones, and they want to get the OPs out of the way. The Jin, Zach, and Zed. Jin is a meta pick right now. The Zed and Zach, I'm guessing that those are just meta picks. We saw Sayonara yesterday. He didn't play Zed. He hovered it quite a bit, but he actually didn't go ahead and lock in that champion. So we'll have to see if he's able to play. Maybe he tries that Rengar again. That just didn't work too well yesterday. Maybe he goes with something a little different that might work for him better. But with the final ban coming out from Penn State, it is going to be that Rengar. So they don't plan on playing it today, so they are going to ban it out. And it's going to be the Graves pickup right away. I believe that is going to go over to LC as a dog, which I'm assuming right now that they are in LCS order. But it looks like Penn State wants to get their bot lane. With the Jin banned out, Varus is the top tier ADC, kind of like standing alone. It's always been for the past couple patches, the Jin, Varus, Ashe, with Ashe kind of falling behind a little bit just because of the lethality buffs don't help her as well as it helps Varus and Jin. So Penn State is able to get Varus, which in my opinion is the top tier ADC, if not the best ADC at this stage of the game. So really glad to see that pick up by Penn State. And the Malzahar pick, even though he was nerfed quite heavily, he is still an amazing support. An ultimate that could just lock you down is amazing in itself. So we're going to see a Lulu lock in here. And that Ashe, we were saying that Ashe with the Jin, Ashe, Varus as the top three. I still think Ashe is a little lacking behind Varus right now, and we'll have to see if that Lulu is going to be support with that Ashe, because we have seen that the Ashe is a bit of a counter, Lulu is a bit of a counter to the Malzahar. You're able to speed up to get away from those Voidlings, you could slow them, you could shield yourself, there's a lot of things you could do against those Voidlings, so there's also a way to interrupt his ultimate too, so as long as you are able to get his passive away, you're able to either whimsy him, you get the knock up with your ultimate. There's many ways to deal with this Malzahar with that Lulu. You're gonna see Crestfallen here. He is hovering that Hecarim, probably gonna go over to Sayonara. If we did see him play Hecarim yesterday, he played extremely well on that, and I wouldn't be surprised if he goes ahead and plays it again. And a lot of hovering champs for the mid lane. They're not sure who they want to go with right now. they had their top lane left open, and in my opinion, Maokai is going to be a contested pick. He's an extremely strong top laner right now, but they're going to go ahead and pick Ekko, which is a little bit of a flex pick. He could go either top or mid. Same with Hecarim, he could be either jungle or top, but I don't think he's really top in this meta anymore. So he's most likely going to be put into that jungle, and I'm going to assume that Ekko is going to be mid for... I actually didn't even see this name. I guess that's Guchan. Sorry if I'm butchering your name. So this Poppy being hovered right here. Poppy's an extremely strong top laner. She's always been ever since her reworked, and I don't think she's ever going to really change all that too much. And if we do see Penn State pick up that Maokai or another top tank top laner, Poppy is one of those that could actually do well against a tank, become a tank herself, and actually deal a surprising amount of damage in that 1v1. So I wouldn't be surprised with that Poppy pick if it goes there. And Ryze as well going to be looking like the mid laner for a light turtle there. Liking the pickup as well. Ryze is an extremely strong mid laner, and yeah, it is going to be that. uLol is going to be in this, and we're going to see uLol most likely. It's going to be on that Lulu this time around, so it is going to be Lulu and Ashe versus the Varus and the Malzahar, and this is going to be most likely a Ryze versus Ekko matchup, and I'm loving the teleport coming out of here by Guchan there. It's going to really help him to gank. It's going to help him to actually deal or keep up with this Ryze, because the Realm Warp, he's able to really just have free roam around the map. The Ekko is at least now going to be able to match those ganks and those roams, and we might see Dubs here going on this Nautilus. We've seen him play a lot of Kank, or Carry. That's where I was thinking of. I kind of mixed Carry and Tank together there, but a Carry-style top laners yesterday when he played the Fiora. He played the first game, which was not a Jax. There's another Carry-style top laner that I can't think of on the top of my head right now, but he played really well on it. Jace, maybe it was. I think it was Jace. I'll have to go back and look at that, but it is going to be a Nautilus, so he's going to go and fit in that tank style. So, look at the teams right now. Both teams are actually going to be, like, fairly bruiser-heavy. You do see Hecarim and Ekko. They kind of had the styles of some of them like to go a little bit tankier with their damage. And you have the Nautilus and the Poppy. They are both going to be just the big tanks. Ryze also building the Rod of Ages, building the scaling items. He's going to be fairly tanky as well, getting a lot of health. And just Graze has a lot of built-in resistances as well as he's in the middle of a fight. So I really like the pickup here. Everyone's really bruiser-ish, besides the bot lane. Bot lane's going to be very squishy, like always. They don't have like a Braum or a Thresh that's going to build pseudo-tank and pseudo-utility. It's just going to be that Malzahar and that Lulu. Lulu probably building like a Redemption, probably a Locket, while Malzahar going to build some damage items, maybe going with the Rylai's and the Leandre's Torment, maybe going with the Redemption himself down the line. We'll have to see. As we are now going to go into our 3-minute delay, I should be joined by Brian relatively soon, and we'll have to see what his idea of this picks and bans and how it went. But in the meantime, as we're waiting right now, just going to look at summoner spells. Really nothing all too special going on. The only difference is the ghost on the Hecarim, which is fairly standard. It's nothing really too abnormal. Going flash on Hecarim is actually something that you don't see too often anymore. But yeah, I'm actually really liking the bot lane coming out here from Ryerson. Penn State did get that top tier. They got the first two picks that they wanted. They got the Malzahar, they got the Varus to be really big lane bullies. But the Ashe has great disengage with the volley, as well as all of her auto attacks always slowing. There's going to be that Lulu that's going to help out as well, getting away from that Malzahar. And it's just a good counter pick to what Penn State picked up. And we're going to have to see how Ninja Hawk is going to be on this Ashe, how he with the ultimates as well as the volleys being able to do a consistent amount of damage. And if Ninja Hawk does survive throughout these fights, she's going to be able to deal a lot of damage as that game goes on. And yep, I'm joined by Brian. How's it going, man?
It's going pretty good. Just finished drafting the team comps for our team.
Yeah, how did you think that went? Kind of like talk to me how you
We were definitely concerned with their jungler, because their jungler does play a lot of Kha'Zix and Rengar. Kha'Zix and Graves. And they ended up banning Jhin. Their AD carry, Jhin is like one of the strongest AD carries in the meta right now, along with Varus. So we just ended up giving Graves, and we picked Varus instead. and they had to pick like one of the suboptimal ADs with Ashe. Mm-hmm. But I mean, overall, I think we're pretty satisfied with our team comp. I feel like we have the edge in this, but we'll see. We'll see how the game goes.
Yeah, I was saying earlier how the one thing though is you had a lot of priority on the bot lane where you picked the Varus and the Malzahar first two rounds, which in my opinion is the top AD carry, which is Varus right now, and one of the top supports, which is Malzahar. How do you feel like Ashe and Lulu is going to do against him? Because I feel like Lulu is kind of a Malzahar counter.
Yeah, Lulu definitely is a Malzahar counter. The thing is, like, we weren't expecting the Lulu pick, but like we haven't actually seen any Lulu games on the support. Maybe he has played it before, but definitely the Ashe is not the best pick into Varus, and I'm definitely confident that our bot lane will win the matchup.
Alright, definitely good to see here. And let's see, when it comes to the Echo versus Ryze matchup, that's actually a matchup I really don't know too much about, but I feel like that Echo might have a little bit of a rough time being melee. What is your opinion is on that?
Yeah, I'm honestly not too sure about that matchup either. We're just honestly letting our mid laner pick what he's more comfortable on, and we wanted to give more priority to our top laner to see, as we picked Echo as in our second rotation before the last pick. We just picked the top laner last. We definitely wanted to scout out the top laner before wanted to scout out the top laner definitely like before we actually picked our top laner. I think we have the edge with our Nautilus pick though. I feel like our team comp is more well rounded out with the Nautilus pick than compared to them with the Poppy.
Yeah, the one thing I like about the Nautilus pick is just how much CC is inbuilt into that champion. And one thing I was surprised that neither team went towards that Maokai instead, because in my opinion, Maokai is one of the better tanks in the game right now, if not the best tank, just because of the built-in sustain, the CC that it brings, as well as when you do those turret dives, a way to get rid of turret aggro off yourself. So is there a reason why you went with the Nautilus instead of such as a Maokai?
Our top laner, Sean's just more comfortable on Nautilus, and he's been really popping off on Nautilus lately, so he definitely prefers the Nautilus.
Yeah, definitely. It's one of those things where going comfort pick is a lot better than going with the OPs. So, no surprise on that one.
And my spectator client is bugged. This is unfortunate.
Are you on the legacy client?
No, I'm on the new one. And like everything's just a black screen right now.
I think it takes a little bit to get in. I've had a similar problem with that, and I actually went back to Legacy just because it's been working better for me. So hopefully we'll be able to get you in to be able to spectate the game. I'm loading in right now. It's taking quite a bit of time.
Oh, I think I'm good.
Alright. Yeah, I'm still loading in. Waiting to see what kind of Keystone Masters are going to come out, because that's always a big part in how these matchups happen. And if you go Curse of the Colossus, if you go Grass of the Undying, stuff like that. But the Varus,
I think we saw the Ryze take Storm Raiders actually. Definitely going for a lot of mobility with the Ghost and the Storm Raiders, as their team does lack some solid engage.
Yeah, that's a good point. They don't have too good of engage. They have the Poppy charging forward, so as long as you're able to stay at a relative distance and not get caught up by walls, it should be fine, actually.
Yeah, the only threats from Ryerson are the Poppy flanks and the Ryze ultimate engages, along with the Ashe picks with the ultimate. Mm-hmm. But honestly, like, the Ryze ultimate and the Poppy TP flanks aren't the most reliable engages. And even so, they have Penn State does have a lot of disengage as well with the Malzahar and the Nautilus. Definitely a lot of zoning as well with the Echo W and the Varus ultimate.
That's definitely true.
We'll see how this plays out.
There's definitely is a lot more of reliable CC coming out from Penn State. RU has a lot of very close range with Ryze. He has to be really close in order to get that W off. Poppy has to be by a wall in order to get the stun off. The only really long range they have is that Ashe ultimate. So as long as Penn State does play around that enchanted arrow, they shouldn't get caught out. Mm-hmm. But as we see, items pretty standard, lanes, just both teams not wanting to do anything crazy. Actually, as I say that, the bot lane for RU is coming up here just to harass a little bit, try to give Sayonara a little bit of a rough time in the jungle, but they're not able to do too much besides just throw a volley their way.
Yeah, Hakram does have a relatively weak early start when he's doing the blue buff, because he runs really low on mana, and you can definitely gimp the Hakram really hard if you do manage to chunk him out, but unfortunately, I don't think they actually managed to, although they did get some priority in this spot lane.
Yeah, there's a lot of poke going down already. Crestfallen already down below half health. Junrei taking quite a bit of harass as well. But trying to go in with those Malzahar minions, but Lulu's just clearing them out so fast. And this is the one thing that Ashe is able to do incredibly well with those volleys, is just harass both the ADC and the support at the same time. And we're seeing as it's taking the toll, as both of the bot laners for PSU are already pretty low.
Yeah, definitely. I think the Varus matchup, you just need to wait until you get the Q on the Varus, and then you can start actually retaliating against the Ashe. But until then, I think definitely the Ashe and Lulu lane have the advantage in terms of range with the volley and the Lulu Q.
Yeah, that's definitely true. And one thing you can probably actually explain to me is, with Varus, you do start that hail or rain of arrows, whatever it's called. And is there a reason why it's so much stronger than starting Q level 1?
I think it's just because it's more consistent. Mm-hmm. You have a much wider range to work with, and if you want to trade with an enemy AD carry and you're like a Varus, and he wants to auto you, you can just E him, and he won't be in auto range, and then he'll be stuck in there. You can probably land another auto off.
Alright, makes sense. Okay.
It's definitely more consistent. Yeah, the bot lane is really going back and forth, whereas we do see a slight CS lead in the top lane. Mid lane has been going really back and forth as well. We've been seeing multiple backs, early backs on from the Ryze to get the tier. Yeah, and early back from the Echo to get more pots and Bronze Ring.
Yeah, and one thing you kind of just did say there is when Varus gets his Q, he's actually able to harass back. And we saw that as Ninja Hog and Peter down here did take a little bit of harass there with that the piercing arrow coming out from Crestfallen. But one thing that does kind of suck here for Penn State now is that Junrei, really low on this Malzahar now, already used all of his potions, is not going to really be able to get in range to throw on a Visions on somebody or even just place Voidlings in a correct position. So it's going to be a little tough now for this bot lane as Junrei is already chunked down so low.
Yeah, and we do see an invade coming through from Ryerson. They definitely do see the bot lane being really low and came to pressure the jungler accordingly.
Yeah, top packs of C4 is actually being taken down pretty low, but a nice steadfast presence there is going to keep him healthy. If he wasn't able to pop that, that probably would have been a kill going over to Dubs. And getting a solo kill at this stage of the game just means so much to get your team going.
Yeah, but Penn State's bot lane is definitely suffering pretty hard here with the Lulu poke and the Ashe poke. Malzahar's just not being able to walk up at all. Once he gets his passive up, he just takes another shot and it's gone.
Yeah, so I expect the backs relatively short soon coming out from Penn State, because it's very surprising coming looking at Peter's mana bar, because he's been poking a lot, especially with Ninja Hog's volleys, and he's still very, very healthy when it comes to mana.
Yeah, most definitely. I think Penn State will just have to try to hold the lane and wait for jungle assistance, or just try to even out the lane as much as they can. There's unfortunately not much they can do at this point.
Yeah, so we are going to see that both bot lanes are backing. Ashe was able to back to get that BF sword, while Varus did back to get the tier, so he is going to have to wait until he gets those items, till he's going to be able to deal quite a bit. And we're actually going to see Go in the top, in the mid lane, take quite a bit of damage. Light Turtle does want to try to finish him off, but he's not able to get in range because of the tower shot. So Light Turtle there just abusing the fact that it's range versus melee and giving this Echo a rough time.
Yeah, I think Echo will just try to have to wave clear in this matchup with the Q. The Ryze does have a lot more consistent damage with the rework. He does have that E wave clear and the poke with the Q and W. And we just see both junglers just farming it out. Hecarim does have a rough early game, or not really rough, but he definitely does want to aim to scale up towards that mid game. Graves has a strong early game, but his laners definitely are winning, and he can just do whatever he can to try to try to bully down the Hecarim as much as he can when the lanes have advantage.
Yeah, both junglers are actually closing in on level 6. LC as a dog is already 6, while Sayonara probably finishing one of his last camps in order to get that final bit of experience there to get his ultimate. But this is just showing how much Graves is a lot faster at clearing than Hecarim. And he did have a little bit of a rough time in the beginning there to get the farm. And you see, the farm is relatively equal, but it all probably determines on what the farm was. Like, did one team get Krugs, one get Raptors, and maybe one didn't. That's the one thing about jungle now is how different the CS means. You can't just look at CS and be like, oh, he's definitely ahead.
Yeah, definitely. With the changes to the jungle camps, I think Riot intended to balance out most of the CSs. But, I mean, honestly, it's really hard to tell how much of one jungler is ahead over another just by telling at the numbers. Definitely have to look at levels and pathing and see, look at how much pressure they're applying. Because, like, one jungler can, like, an early game especially, one jungler can just take Krugs, and instantly that's, like, what, 10 camps? Whereas the jungler, 10, can, yeah. One other jungler can gank another lane, and it might seem like he's behind, but that wouldn't actually always be the case.
Yeah, it's crazy to think how, like, the camps are now between 1 and 10 minions in it, so it's really tough to tell of who's ahead now in the jungle matchup by just looking at CS. But we are seeing a little bit of a gold lead coming out. A 5k gold, or sorry, not 5k, half a thousand gold lead going in favor of RU, as just the farm game is going in their favor. They have really not too much of a lead. It's just a little bit here and there, but that little bit is giving them that, 300 gold now. So maybe it was just how backings were working.
Oh, we do see a gank coming around mid.
Yeah, Sayonara jumping on a light turtle, but not able to get him away from that turret, so he's going to be safe there. He's actually going to be dealing quite a bit of damage as the Hecarim is forced to run away, so the gank really didn't do too much there, and light turtle with that blue buff is just going to be able to spam out the damage. Here comes the ultimate, but it's still going to land after the flash, but he's under tower. It's going to be enough to stay alive. That's going to be first blood going over to LC as the dog picks it up with that ultimate from the Graves.
Yeah, and just a successful gank on Ryerson's side. Set up with the arrow, and then just getting all the damage off, and that's straight up a kill onto the Malzahar, who is relatively squishy right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even though the arrow did land on a Crestfall and just wasn't able, like, they realized that he was still full health, just going to Junrei, he's extremely low, and they were able to kill him under tower before he was able to back off. The heal still went through, too, so they killed him through that, and it was that last bit of damage from the collateral damage, which was able to give that Graves the kill.
Yeah, Ryerson does have a lot of range with their jungle and their bot lane. They can definitely deal a lot of damage from afar. And that definitely worked really well for them, seeing as the Malzahar with just basically got chunked all the way down and just died.
So now this is going to put LC as a dog a lot farther ahead of Sayonara, but Junrei going to get caught out here. He still has the flash from the last gank, but he's going to go down. Light Turtle is going to pick up that one, and now Yuchan there forced to run away as well. Sayonara is going to be here to help him defend this tower, but that was just Junrei getting caught there. Oh, and Light Turtle actually gets a return kill as well. That's going to be two kills going in favor of RU as they take quite a bit of an early lead here, and they're going to get a dragon for their troubles.
And we do see the Lulu posturing around. I'm not sure if they'll try to go for a dive on the bot lane after they take Dragon. It seems like they're actually doing that. There is a TP coming through for Ryerson. Seems like they're just trying to force this tower and kill on the Varus.
Yeah, the Chanted Arrow landed. That's going to be another kill. Pax to C4 picks this one, and Junrei going a little too far forward is going to get caught out as well. Double kill going over to Pax of C4. So that's going to be two more kills and a tower going over to Ryerson.
Yeah, definitely a well set up dive. They saw that the tower was low, and they saw that the Varus was alone, and executed a pretty straightforward dive with the TP coming through, and now they're just 5 manning bot, getting as much damage as they can before they reset.
Yeah, and because of really no rotation coming in, they actually might be able to get a tier 2 for themselves as well. as no one from Penn State is nearby. They are showing up now, but the tower is already going to be gone. The ultimate coming up from Sayonara. The damage comes through, but is it going to be enough as he's getting chunked down right now? He's going to go down. Ninja Hawk picks that one up as Gyujin comes in. Can he find the damage? He was exhausted, so he wasn't able to do too much. The ultimate coming in from Pax of C4, knocking up the Malzahar, stopping his ultimate. That's going to be a double kill for the Ash, actually a triple kill for Ninja Hawk there as Ryerson just takes this game in their hands.
Yeah, definitely a commanding lead right now for Ryerson after that team fight. I'm not sure if Penn State should have engaged that. The Nautilus did cancel the TP earlier, and they definitely were down a member. While Ryerson were low, they do have a lot of disengage with the mobility they have, and they have a lot of lockdown with the Ryze W, and they do have a lot of damage. Yeah, and there's a good exhaust on top of the Echo from the Lulu, as well as just good peel with the Lulu ultimate on top of the Ash to peel off the Hecarim, and they just played that really well and managed to get a really big advantage off of that.
Yeah, they got a tier 2, a lot of kills out of that. Sayonara just came a little bit late, so that once he jumped in, the tower was already gone, and that's going to be a 5k gold lead now going over to RU as Penn State now, 2 towers behind, 8 kills behind, has to really turtle to try to do something to get back in this game. So now at this point,
we'll see what Ryerson will do right now. Penn State definitely just needs to set up a line of vision and just play it safe. And the advantage is definitely towards Ryerson now, and they definitely have the initiative in terms of what they can do with this lead. And we do see the jungler coming towards the top lane, and it seems like most of the members are posturing towards the top to pressure that top tower.
Yeah, Sayonara coming up here.
We should see the game slow down a bit. Both sides just kind of want to get a favorable lane wave shoved in on the sides, and then just pressure wherever they have the advantage in terms of positioning.
Yeah, and we're going to see Dubs up here just be able to tank up so much. Pax of C4 is going to be under tower. Sayonara is going to be here to help him out, though, but it's going to be a 2v3 as the Lulu comes in. Junior A popping in as well. The entire Penn State team is here, so this would be a 5v4 if a fight does start up. We do see Ryze is on his way, but
yeah,
it might take quite a bit.
Through. This might be engaged coming through. Oof, and the hook barely misses.
Yeah, if that hook would have landed, that probably would have been a really good engage coming out from Penn State, because it would have took Ryze quite a bit of time to get up here to the top side. And a 5v4, even though that you're 5k behind, is something that you could win, and it could have been a way for Penn State to get back into this game.
Yeah, definitely. There is a lot of scaling on Ryerson's side. Ash has just finished the Essence Reaver, and she typically doesn't spike as hard until she gets 3 items. So there definitely is a window for Penn State to force a favorable fight. And there is a hook plan.
Yeah, it goes on to LC Dub. Dubs is going to get locked down by Pax of C4, who is under tower. They're going to find Peter Lola. Are they going to be able to kill him? The ultimate's going to come through. He's going to drop. Crestfallen picks that one up, and it's actually going to be 2 kills going in favor of Penn State. Can they kill Pax of C4 as well? They don't drop anybody as Sayonara gets that 3rd kill for Penn State, and this is them trying to get back in the game.
Yeah, and as we were just saying, it was a 5v4. Well, a 4v4 as Echo moved back mid, but there definitely was that window where Penn State, although they were behind in items, in terms of power spikes, they definitely weren't that far behind. Although Ash was 3-0, she definitely does not do as much damage as the Varus with the Dirk. And that is why Varus is so heavily prioritized, along with Jhin. The lethality AD carries just have so strong power spikes early on, despite having just 1 or 2 items.
Yeah, now with that Yumu's being picked up, even though that item was just nerfed, it's still amazing for Varus to get that to now a huge power spike. As you were saying, the Essence Reaver for Ash is not as big as the Yumu's for Varus. And with that tier giving him quite a bit of mana, it's going to allow him to just throw the piercing arrows whenever he wants.
Yeah, great team fight from Penn State, and they managed to slowly claw back into it. They definitely still are in the disadvantage here. They do need to play it safe. Ryerson does have that advantage. They still are 4k gold ahead. And, I mean, that was a 4v4 team fight that Penn State won, but will they actually be able to win a 5v5 team fight? It's the question here.
Yeah, that's the thing. It was without the Ryze and the Echo, and we're seeing just from the stat lines is how Ryze is pretty far ahead of Echo right now, already getting that Rod of Ages stacking and as well as that tier, while Echo just has the Proto Belt right now, not too much damage on that mid laner. So we'll have to see if the 5v5 comes out of how impactful these mid laners are going to be.
Yeah, and Ryze is definitely a very important part of Ryerson's team composition. Ooh. He provides most of the mobility and consistent damage that Ryerson does lack. He also provides that really good lockdown with the W.
And Guchen does get locked down a little bit by Pax of C4, but Sayonara is going to be here. But Junray gets cut out, and that's going to be another kill going over to LC as a dog. They're trying to get a kill onto Pax of C4, but two people are going to go flying. And now Guchen is all by himself, and he's at least going to be able to get away because he's very mobile. But great ultimate coming out from Pax of C4 to keep himself alive.
Yeah, and with a pick like that, Ryerson can just straight up turn to Dragon, and it's going to be uncontested.
Yeah, so that's now two dragons in the favor of RU with that 5k gold lead. It's really going to help them. The only thing is, this doesn't really help their team comp too much. They're not too much of a sieging team, so they won't be like trying to continually going after these towers. But just having that is going to help out as the game goes on to later stages.
Yeah, definitely. And next dragon's action, Infernal Dragon. You do see a large variety of dragons coming through. Earth Dragon and Infernal typically are considered to be the better dragons, as they definitely do provide you with the stats you want and utility that you want.
Yeah, exactly. So as this game moves on, there's going to be a lot of priority on that Infernal Drake. We did see that Penn State really didn't, they kind of gave over not only the Ocean Drake but the Mountain Drake. They didn't want to go too aggressive for it. They did realize that they didn't want to fight a 5v4, or they didn't have the inner lane, so they knew that they wouldn't be able to fight it, so they didn't want to go for those two dragons, which are fairly low priority, but the Infernal Drake might be something that they're willing to fight over.
Yeah, definitely. Infernal Drakes just provide a lot of damage spikes. It just straight up just boosts your whole entire team's damage up by a lot, and that's definitely something that you definitely want to contest over.
And we're seeing a little bit of a siege here coming out from RU in this mid lane. They have four strong here, but so does Penn State. So the defense coming in now, we'll have to see how well the wave clear is for Penn State. And it seems like it's good enough right now that they're not able to really do too much damage to this tower. But because it's so low, all they need to do is for each wave, just chip it down little by little, and it'll eventually fall.
Yeah, that Varus definitely does provide a lot of wave clear. As the minions are lining up, you can just throw one Q as Varus, and I think all the casters just die in that combo. And we do see this Varus pull coming through. Ash is getting chunked really low.
Yeah, the one thing that does help is, though, that Ocean Drake is going to heal him up. The ultimate's going to come through. It does land onto Crestfallen. Damage comes through. Light Turtle, though, locked on under tower. No one's dropping just yet, but there goes Light Turtle. He's going to be the first one to drop, so it's 1-0 so far for Penn State. But Sayonara is going to go down, so it's going to be just a 1-for-1 trade. They lose their tower in the process, too. They're going to re-engage here as Dubs lands the hook, and he's going to be able to get the shutdown gold onto the Ash. That's already two kills going over to Penn State. Can they continue into this as Dubs gets the double kill, and LZ is a dog, is going to be caught out. Crestfallen picks that one up, and now it's just Pax of C4 left. He sends Dubs away, but there's still three strength for Penn State, but they win the fight even though they lost their tower.
Yeah, definitely a really great engage from Dubs. He just, even though both sides traded kills, he just knew that their team would win and engaged he had a really good hook on top of the grades, and just managed to get inside all three of the members of Ryerson that were alive and just did so much damage. Penn State just managed to clean that up. Let's see what Penn State managed to get here. I don't think they'll be getting much out of this. There definitely is a threat from the other enemy teams to come back early. Mm-hmm. And yeah, Ryerson's just coming back mid to defense, and although Penn State does win the fight, they won't be able to get much. They definitely will, however, claw back into the game, just, again, slowly, bit by bit.
Yeah, they're still pretty far behind, but they're able to win these team fights as it happens. And being 5k behind and consistently winning team fights is something that probably shouldn't be happening too often. And it makes me wonder how much this game would be different if Penn State didn't give it over those 8 early kills and going 8-0. Because since then, it's now 7-2 in Penn State's favor. So it probably could have been much different depending on how this game would have went. But as we say that, Penn State slowly trying to claw their way in, but as the death timers are still relatively low, they're still not able to take a tower off from that. So 4-0 behind, that's probably where a lot of this goal lead is.
Yeah, definitely. There's just a really good line of defense from Ryerson. They're always sending their members to clear out the side waves before they reach the tower, getting minimal damage off on top of their towers. And Penn State just needs to wait for an opportune moment to either engage a fight or shove out a side wave to actually get a favorable position in the map.
But like you said, the game has its highs and lows. We're back in one of the slow peats where both teams just trying to get some sort of advantage with their minion pushes. And as we see this, there is quite a bit of damage on both the bot and the top tower. And RU is doing a great job at defending this top tower as they're going to continue the siege down here in this mid lane, going for their second tier 2. But it is a much harder tower to take as you're basically in your enemy's zone. They have their own jungle warded, so they're able to basically have an easier time flanking than if you were trying to siege that tier 1 tower.
Yeah, and Ryerson does have a hard time sieging these towers because of Penn State's team composition as well. We do see the Nautilus and Varus threat coming, and Malzahar threat coming through. If Ryerson does try to siege or get too close, Penn State can engage a really favorable fight with the Malzahar ultimate or the Nautilus ultimate or even the Varus ultimate. And that's just a lot of CC load on top of each other. And props to Ryerson for realizing this. They're playing it slow. They have the lead. They don't want to risk too much to force a tower that they could possibly lose fight after with. And they're just waiting for the next dragon to spawn, shoving in the waves, applying pressure to Penn State, and just acquiring vision over the dragon, and that, as there are only 15 seconds left until the dragon spawns, you do see a lot of vision on Ryerson over this dragon pit, whereas Penn State just needs to play reactive as the minions are shoved into their tower, and they just need to wait for the moment.
And this is going to be a big dragon to take, and Dubs having teleport might want to come down here relatively soon, because it's going to be started immediately by RU, because this is a win-win situation for them, because either a fight breaks out or they're going to be able to get a free dragon, and the fight, as we said, should be in their favor as Dubs isn't here yet. But look at the damage being on the dragon already. That's going to be Sayonara not getting there in time as Guchan gets locked down. He's not able to do too much damage just yet, but here comes Dubs. The teleport's going to go through, but Sayonara already going to drop Guchan. Getting the shield is going to be able to live for now, but the flash forward by Ninja Hawk is going to be able to pick up that kill, and Crestfallen going to drop as well as Ninja Hawk gets himself a double kill. The Realm Warp coming in for the re-engage, not able to use it, no one goes through, but Junrei getting locked up with a flash body slam coming out from Pax to C4, and Dubs, the last one alive, not able to get away, actually just barely able to get away, but here goes Pax at C4 for the ace, 4RU.
Yeah, Penn State definitely was a mistake to re-engage that team fight after they had such a poor positioning inside that choke point. Ryerson does have a lot of soft CC with that Lulu slow and the Ashe W, and I think Penn State definitely was out of position and they tried to force that team fight again, although they could have just backed out, and that definitely went in the favor of Ryerson.
Yeah, one thing we said, how Penn State was winning the fights, but that was because they were playing on their terms. They had great positioning, great engages, and that's what gave them the win. This time they had fairly poor positioning, and just from that, it was enough for RU to basically have a stranglehold on this game and get a 5-0 in that fight. And we were saying how Penn State was slowly coming back. That basically just undid everything that happened in the past 10 minutes.
Yeah, and as we see, it's almost a 10k gold lead right now. All Ryerson needs to do right now is just pressure Baron, and we'll see how. Oh, as I say that, there is Nero coming through, but I don't think Ryerson's going to get much from this. But yeah, as I was saying, Ryerson definitely just needs to pressure Baron now, as there is an open bot lane inhibitor. Echo does have that teleport, however, he can choose to just sit bot lane, wait for something action to happen in the Baron pit, and then teleport over to join his team, as Penn State can just defend Baron with the Varus Q. Varus definitely is a really strong red side pick, with the poke and the control over a Baron, basically. You can just stand behind the walls and just safely poke.
Yeah, right there, he lands the piercing arrow onto three members, but just not enough damage just yet in order to be too impactful. Landing that on Ninja Hog, though, dealt quite a bit of damage. The Ash is now below half health, but because RU, with the great rotation, is going to be able to come up here to go for the tower, that's going to be a lot of tower damage, but Penn State might want to try to find an engage there. Pax is C4, like, taking no damage from this Varus. Sayonara tries to go in again, but just not able to find the damage or redemption coming through. But uLol going to be the first one down. Jundray gets hit by the arrow, but because of his passive, is not going to be locked down. Ninjahawk does get hit with another piercing arrow, but that's going to be one kill going over to RU. And Sayonara not able to finalize anybody as Jundray now is going to be locked in. Great snipe coming out from Crestfallen as he picks up a kill as well. But that's still going to be in favor of RU as they're just going to continue this push. And that's a triple kill going over to Light Turtle.
Yeah, and although the fight did seem to be pretty even early on, the tank line from Penn State definitely just crumbled way faster than Ryerson's did.
Realm
and as
Warp
we see the
Rise
Ultimate coming through, and that's another pick coming through for Ryerson. But yeah, Ryerson are just so far ahead, although the fight did start on Penn State's turn, and they did definitely did get that pick off on the Lulu early. They definitely did overcommit a bit, and Ryerson just managed to clean that fight up with their lead.
Yeah, just a great cleanup coming out from Ryerson, and just Pax of C4 being an immense frontline right now, taking almost no damage and still having a GA, so they had to somehow find a way to get through Pax of C4 to get to the backline. And we saw the Varus arrows were doing quite a bit of damage, but at this stage, being 12k behind, losing two of your inhibitors, I wonder if this is one of those things where Penn State just has to hope for, like, just think about, start thinking about game two, because I believe this is a best of three, correct?
Yep.
Yeah.
This is a best of three, and this is game one of the best of three. Both teams definitely could just use this as a starting point. I mean, both teams haven't played each other before. Mm-hmm. They could be using this game to scout out the other team's intentions and the play styles, and Penn State definitely could start thinking about that, but this game definitely is not over yet. Although there are two inhibitors down, Penn State is 12k behind, but they definitely do have that possibility of forcing a good team fight. And as death timers do get pretty long, as the game goes late, there definitely is a possibility for a turnover. But we do see Ryerson is sneaking Baron with just the Graves and the Rise. Penn State does spot this out, however, the good game intuition, and I think Ryerson will just have to back out here.
Yeah, they're not going to be able to continue on that. Looks like there might be a pause. At least my client is...
Client's frozen as well. Yeah. So most likely a pause.
Yeah, it's one of these things where I think it's a bug with the spectator system. It's been really weird with this latest patch. And I've noticed before that I think it is when teams pause, we don't see the pause screen anymore. It just pauses like it would if we would have paused it.
Yeah, definitely some spaghetti. And as I say that, my client is frozen again.
Yeah, same here. So it is definitely that they were just pausing right now. It's weird that there's nothing going on through chat unless we're just not able to see that for some reason, because like you said, spaghetti, it happens. But yeah, this is one of those games where Penn State needs to find some sort of picks. They need a turtle very well to get into the point of the game where they could choose their team fight, because we've seen when they're able to choose their own team fights, they are able to win them. So we'll have to see as this game goes longer is how many of those team fights they're actually going to be able to find.
Yeah, and I think my client did manage to get on the pause screen. It seems like Light Turtle did DC. It was a pause from Ryerson. Yeah, and let's talk about the game a little. It seems like the only objective left for Ryerson is that Baron, and with that Baron and the two inhibitors, they could just honestly end the game if they take that. Penn State definitely does want to hold off against this Baron, and it definitely will prove to be a challenge with the two side lanes shoving in with Baron with inhibitor minions.
Yeah, I feel like Ryerson right now, they realize at this point in the game where they're able to win, they have a massive goal lead, but there have been times where Penn State did win fights. They don't want to give over a lucky Baron steal to Saranoia, which allows Penn State now to come back in this game. All Penn State needs to do, they need a turtle, they need to wait for the later in the games. Like you said, once the death timers get too long, Penn State wins a good fight, they're going to get a lot of towers off of it, get some objectives, and bringing that gold lead closer is going to benefit Penn State.
Yeah, and hopefully Ryerson doesn't have too many issues with their disconnect. Yeah, this game's the game plans for both teams is honestly pretty straightforward at this point. Ryerson definitely just wants that Baron to help them siege and end the game, whereas Penn State just wants to hold off against this Baron and get as much as they can while they just keep farming and shoving waves. because not much Penn State can do at this point with a 12k deficit. Definitely just need to either look for an opportune fight or just shove out waves in the meantime and put up a line of vision and just play around that.
And play around it if they're even able to. We've seen a lot of times that RU just quickly pull the trigger and they're able to get kills before Penn State can even react sometimes. So if RU is going to be able to continue to do that, it's just going to be really tough for Penn State because they are having a rough time 5v5 in team fights sometimes, even when they are able to choose their engage. But if a 5v4 happens, I feel like there would be no chance for Penn State to win out of that because everybody is very viable on Penn State's side. They have two great backline divers. They have someone who could poke out really far. They have a great lockdown as well. If they're missing just one person, that's a lot gone for Penn State.
Yeah, definitely. Penn State does have that wave clip with the Varus Q and the Echo Q. They definitely do just want to poke out Ryerson. They definitely could poke out Ryerson pretty well with the Varus Q and perhaps hinder the Baron attempts. But we'll just have to see how well Ryerson manages their bot and top waves and coordinates that with their Baron pressure.
Yeah, definitely. As we did see that Light Turtle seem to reconnect. I think they're just trying to like make sure that everything is good before they unpause this game. Because being 7-1-3, they definitely want to make sure that Light Turtle is as comfortable as he can be, not lagging at all. They don't want him to drop by some sort of just unfortunate internet issues, which could cost him a game. Because one thing we actually didn't look at just the individual gold here right here, and a lot of the gold lead is in that mid and jungle. 4,000 apiece out of that. That's immense at this stage of the game.
Yeah, definitely. The Kraze does have a lot of assists and kills, and their mid laner just has straight up had 7 kills. Whereas the Hecarim and the Echo are really behind with only 1 kill on the Hecarim and none on the Echo, as well as a CS lead on the Ryze compared to the Echo. Definitely is something that is very important to these teamfights. We did see the Echo overcommit a few times in these teamfights and ended up dying for that. We'll have to see how this turns out.
Yeah, and I just realized there once you pointed out that this Graves, LC is a dog right here, right now has a 95% kill participation. That is pretty crazy at any stage of the game to have.
Yeah, definitely. This is typically a sign of good teams and coordinated teams. You just see their teams moving along with their jungler to coordinate ganks and coordinate plays. And typically when your jungler's not there, unless you see an opportune moment where you are sure you can take an advantage or in a team fight, you typically just want to play around your jungler. Play as a 5-man or a 4-man or even a 3-man depending on your team composition. But yeah, well executed game from the Graves. That kill participation definitely does say a lot of Ryerson's coordination and communication.
Yeah, going back to the items right now. Varus here completing his 3 items, but we also said that once Ashe is able to pick up 3 items, that's like one of her major power spikes right now. And she's finishing up that Bloodthirster, and once that's done, it's just going to be huge for RU as they're going to be able to finish this game. Ashe is going to be extremely strong once she picks up that item. It looked like for a second that they unpaused, but still just client spaghetti happening where it was still paused for like a little extra 10 seconds, but now we are back in the game finally. And just as a recap what happened, RU did try to sneak a Baron there with the Ryze and the Graves. They just weren't able to do it as they were caught up. But Crestfallen going to get knocked up by that arrow, and he is going to go down. Packs a C4, picks up that one with a hammer, and that is just going to be a very quick kill going over to RU, and they're going to get the tower, and they're going to continue the siege as they go in for the last Inhibitor standing. I don't think this is going to be an easy defense coming from Penn State as their main source of wave clear is now gone. And And yeah, the siege is going to continue. The inhibitor tower going to draw. Penn State not really able to do anything right there, as that's going to be a inhibitor dropping. And with another inhibitor spawning, they have no relief, as one inhibitor spawns just to die 5 seconds after it comes alive. So RU here just on top of everything, getting everything. And the game is going to continue, though. Dubs go in for an engage. This might be a very desperation engage, as the Barris does respawn, but they're not able to put the damage in just yet. The backline Ninja Hog, though, does take an arrow, and Junray, though, gets locked down. He's going to drop. Guchan goes for, but not able to find the damage just yet. But Sayonara does pick up one of the kills, using his ultimate in a defense tool, though. Not able to find the damage. Ninja Hog finds the damage on to Guchan. He drops. Light Turtle picks another one. He is dominating right now as Crestfallen drops again. And this is going to be RU taking game one.
Yeah, really well executed game plan just from RU. Set up some really nice early plays and taking game one in this best of three series. I am going to go coach the team a bit. I'll come back later after I finish talking to them and drafting for the second game.
Yep, sounds good. Just great teamwork there coming out of RU, their jungler. 23 out of 25 kill participation. Ended the game with 92. Went a little bit less than the 95, but still, 92 kill participation is amazing. So great job there coming out from RU. Just a little bit of sloppiness, though, coming out from the mid lane, where they did allow Penn State to get a few of those kills during those fights, and that's something that they can't really allow next time, because they had an 8-0 lead, and Penn State was able to bring it back to a 10-7. Still lead for RU, but that 7-2 swing could have been really huge. Penn State just not able to find the tower damage, wasn't able to find that big burst of gold, so they weren't really able to come back in this game. So in the meantime, I'm going to go ahead, take a little bit of break, get some water, and I'm going to play some music, but we'll be back in the next game relatively soon. Alright, we are getting back into it. Sadly, I had to turn off Silver Scrapes there, but we're going to go right into the next game. Penn State's going to be on the blue side with RU going to be on the red side this time around. So we'll have to see how this changes the game, but it seems like similar bands in LeBlanc is still going to come out for Penn State. As we go on, the Zed's still going to be banned out. They don't want Gochan there to have that Zed. Rengar not allowing LC as a dog to have that champion. Probably going to be a Kha'Zix or a Graves as well, because we did hear earlier that LC as a dog is a huge Kha'Zix and a huge Graves player. So what I think Penn State might actually do here is ban the Graves or the Kha'Zix and then pick the other one, just so then you are completely banning out LC as a dog's champion pool. He played amazing on that Graves last time, so trying to, with that, like we said, he had a 92% kill participation, so trying to take away someone that had such a good impact in the game and giving him on one of the weaker champions that he's not used to playing is going to be a great thing right here. But instead, they're going about the Varus, so this is going to be the two top tier ADCs are going to be gone. So this might be an Ashe first pick instead, but this is allowing LC as a dog to basically pick whatever he wants. And we said Kha'Zix, big player, Graves, big player, Zac. We're going to see Sayonara not be able to play on the tank style jungler that he might just be used to playing. So just a huge ban there by RU, and it's going to be the Kha'Zix first pick. So the Graves is still open. I feel like LC as a dog just going to go ahead and play it. He played amazing last game. Sayonara had a fairly weak game on the Hecarim, so it is just going to be that Ashe pickup and the Graves. So not the greatest of decisions here, I think, out of Penn State. I feel like the Kha'Zix could have been down the line, or if you did pick Kha'Zix, ban the Graves instead of the Varus. But I just feel like they just didn't want RU to have that Varus, but instead they gave over the Graves, which LC's dog we already saw played amazing on. They're giving over that Ninja Hog to have the Ashe, which again we saw he played pretty well on finding those arrows. So just a lot given up here by Penn State, in my opinion. But now at this stage of the game, what's left? They pick up their jungler that they wanted, but LC the dog was still able to get a jungler that he wanted. You gave away the ADC that RU wanted, so what other ADC are you going to play? Are you going to play like an Ezreal, or maybe go Vayne and go so hyper carry and allow Crestfallen to try to carry the game that way? I don't think it's the greatest decision, but I'm just trying to spitball here to see what they want to do. It seems like it might be the Caitlyn, though. A very safe AD carry to be able to poke from long range. And I would like it, and with the Nami being able to protect the Ashe as much as, or sorry, to protect that Caitlyn, I do like the pickup there. So it is going to be the Caitlyn Nami bot lane. And the one thing I love about Caitlyn with anybody who has any hard form of CC, her traps basically lock down people for an extended portion of time. It's like a CC extender, and it still gives you a lot of damage with those headshots. But Pax C4 played amazing on that Poppy. Just give it to them again. So no point of playing anything different if you don't have to. The only thing different is Light Turtle is going to be on the Zyra instead, which Zyra Ashe is just such a dominating bot lane. It's no surprise they're going to go with it. So instead of a Lulu, it's going to be a Zyra, which I really don't mind. I actually really like that, especially against this Nami Caitlyn. Make the Nami use that heal or that mana to sustain the Caitlyn back up. So great pickups here coming out of RU, and Penn State here had to decide of what they wanted to do. Dubs played pretty well on that Nautilus last time. He found the picks when he needed to. He was actually able to 1v1 Ninja Hog in the, or sorry, Paxus C4 in the early stage of the game. So he might go with the similar thing. But then what is Guchan going to play on this mid lane? The Echo had a lot to desire for. He wasn't able to find the assassinations with it, and he just got bullied by that Ryze. And he's just going to try it again, though. We've seen it so many times in these style of plays that you had a bad game one, doesn't matter, play the same champion, you'll do well this time around, and it does work sometimes. So the only problem is that this does give Light Turtle a chance to play that Ryze again and completely counter. And this is just RU playing a very similar team comp that they played last time. So now RU here with their last pick, it is going to be a mid laner unless Light Turtle is going to hold on to that Zyra, which is doubtful. It is going to be a Syndra, which I feel like is going to really be able to bully this melee Echo. And it's going to be really tough for Guchan here to just try to do anything in the terms of farming. And I feel like it's going to be a huge advantage going over to RU. So I'm really interested to see what Brian has to say when he gets back on this picks and bans. I feel like Penn State gave up a little too much in the the opening ban. I feel like giving over both that Graves and the Ash was just a little too much. So I just have some questions on him of how that happened, of that last ban of Avaris. Because instead of just giving over one big pick, like, oh, you gave him the Avaris, that's fine. You put LC Dog on a champion that he didn't want to play. This time around, though, you gave him both Ash and that Graves. So this is something we'll have to talk to him once he's back in here. But he's going to do his last bit of coaching before he comes in here. But yeah, very similar team comp. It's just going to be the mid laner and the support going to be a little bit different for RU. It's going to be that Syndra instead and that Zyra in the bot lane, and that's just going to really help with it. All right, Brian just sent me a message. It seems like he's not going to join me for this next game. So it looks like I'm going to be solo casting with you guys. So we'll see how it goes. I usually try to avoid this as much as possible. But he said his throat's heart hurting, so he doesn't want to strain his voice, which makes sense. No surprise. So we're going to get into this game. So we're actually not going to be able to hear from Brian about what he wanted to do with this picks and bans. But Crestfallen going to be playing on this Kaylin is a little bit of... just going away, because we do say that the top tier ADCs probably in order goes Varus, Jhin, and then Ashe. Caitlyn is arguably fourth or fifth, Ezreal somewhere in there as well. So it's just a little bit of a rough pick coming out here for Penn State. Oh man, not really sure what else to talk about here. The bot lane is going to be just very aggressive coming out from RU. The Ashe and the Zyra are just going to be able to bully very hard Crestfallen and Jhunrei right here on both the Nami and the Caitlyn. It's just going to be pretty rough for them. Luckily, they do have that sustain, and Nami is actually really good in sustain. One of the better sustain champions in the game right now. Of course, there's like Soraka who heals much more. But yeah, just Nami, because of the disengage, the engage that it brings up, it's just so good in my opinion at this stage of the game. So for the last minute, I'm going to go ahead and finish up that song that we were playing earlier, and we'll be back for this game, which I feel like is going to be a really good one. And I feel like RU got the better of the picks and bans here, but Penn State, they showed that in that mid game last time that they were able to win some team fights. So hopefully they don't go too far behind in the early stages and they'll be able to come back. So in the meantime, let's finish up Silver Scrapes. All right, we are going to be back in. I'm going to allow it to finish the song off in the background. I'm not going to stop it just yet. But we're going to see here, are you on the red side? Penn State on the blue side. Penn State needs this win in order to stay alive. And if they drop this game, they are going to be out of the uLol playoffs. And their collegiate lives are basically on the stake here for maybe some people who are seniors. This could be their last game in the CSL and the uLol program. So they're going to give it their all, hope to get the win here, while RU at the same time wants to move on. They want to be able to show that they are going to be a great team in this. And Ryerson is a team that a lot of people probably haven't heard of before, but that could change after this tournament. So fairly standard stuff coming in from the items. We will see both of the AD carries actually starting that Doran's Blade. Sometimes you'll see them start longsword if they're going for the more lethality build, such as going into a U move as soon as you can. Getting that serrated Dirk on the first back. But because both of them are pretty standard AD carries, not going to be going with these lethality builds, we're going to see that both of them will start with that that Doran's Blade and just going to allow them to stay a little bit healthier as this game goes on. Now, they won't have the sustain from the pots, but granted, Caitlyn doesn't need it because he has an Ami. So we'll have to see if they're going to be able to get Ninja Hog out of lane pretty soon. And if you could stop the Ashe from getting BF Sword on her first back, that's pretty massive. So just harass coming through, and actually Penn State being the aggressors this time, so they're going to be the ones with the level 1 fight here in their favor. So good decision out of Penn State here to make it so that they don't get pushed behind like they were last time. RU, though, dealing quite a bit of damage back, but the Nami going to be able to sustain that right back up. Besides that, not too much. We're going to see Guchen there actually missing quite a bit of damage, but gets the return on the Q. So that does allow him to get that third proc, gets that movement speed, and gets out of there, and just deals so much damage there over to Light Turtle, forcing him to use a pot already. Granted, one Corruption Potion usage has been used as well, so it's going to be fairly even in this bot lane as it's just going to continue with them fighting against each other. So nothing too strange going on at this point. Stuff is very standard. The one thing that might be a little surprising though is Dubs going with that Doran's Ring on the top side, but he wants to be able to try to bully past the C4 as much as he can. Going a Corruption Potion would have not allowed him to get enough damage in here, but the damage is going to come through as the bubble lands. Not able to get traps though in place is Crestfallen. Maybe not even leveling that up yet. Not sure what he went second on that Caitlyn. No, he did go trap, so just wasn't in range to place. I didn't want to go too far forward because Peter would have just been able to aggressively went on him, locking him down, and a little bit of damage is not worth the majority of your health pool, because that's what Zyra can do at these early levels if the plants are in the right spots. So we do see that LC Dog with an early back, got a couple of long swords for himself, and he's making his way closer to this top side. We do see Dubs a little bit extended, so this might be LC Dog thinking that he can come in for a pretty easy gank here, especially if the Poppy can find a stun with her hero charge, or just find some way to not allow the Nautilus to get away, especially with your Courage of the Colossus being used there. If LC Dog does decide to come up here, that's going to be a big shield that won't be available. So with this fight going on, the Buckler is going to help Pax of C4 to stay a little bit healthier, but we're going to see that Grave start is making his way up here, but perfect timing. Kha'Zix is going to as well, and they won't see Kha'Zix, but they will see the Grave. So as Graves comes in here, this is going to be a good counter gank if Kha'Zix does go in, and I don't know if they saw him or not, so just a good usage of the Fog of War there by Kha'Zix not being seen. He's just been spotted out now. So LC's a dog with, I guess, a second sense there, decided not to go fully in there. And if he would have, that just could have been massively in favor of Penn State's side, just because of how much surprise effector it would have had. But the damage coming through his Crestfallen already extremely low there, just being chunked down so low. uLol trying to find the kill here, just not quite able to find the placement, though, of that Stranglethorns to lock him in place. We see Poppy getting a very early Null Magic Mantle, and I believe this is probably going to go into that Spirit Visage to help her out as this game goes down. She doesn't want to take that consistent damage away from that Nautilus, and not a bad decision here. Granted, majority of the rest of the damage coming out from PSU is going to be that cause. It's going to be that Caitlyn, so she's going to have a rough time if very early Roams come in. If the Kha'Zix comes in for a gank, she's going to have a tough time with trying to defend that, so... We're going to see, though, Kha'Zix coming in the bot side, going on to uLol, just being able to check them so low. The Flash Bubble is not going to land, but that's going to be First Blood going over to Crestfallen as Ninjahawk forced to flash away. So great usage of the Summoner spells coming out from Penn State, and a great gank coming out from Sayonara as they get First Blood. So this is exactly what Penn State needed, something completely different from Game 1 to give them the advantage in this fight. And Dubs in the top side here, just dealing a little bit of damage from Pax's C4. This is an average top lane fight. They're just going to whittle each other away. No big all-in's going to happen just yet. But Pax's C4 might be a little too close to tower there. I don't think he could have been hooked under just yet, though. But he has to realize that Dubs is 6. So there is a lot of lockdown potential there from that Nautilus. But being very low in mana, not going to be able to do too much, though. As he doesn't have that Corruption Potion for that sustain in both health and mana, so he's going to need to get some of that minion wave to help him get some mana back with that Doran Ring. But with his usage of that E, or the Riptide, it's not really going to help him get back any more mana, so it's not going to be a big all-in anytime soon in the top side. Very interesting bot lane fight there for a Pink Ward. Just a little bit of damage thrown here and there, but the Pink Ward was cleared out by Ryerson. But 500 gold lead coming in the side of Penn State. This is exactly, like we said earlier, this is exactly what Penn State needed to come back in this game. Without it, they would have been just massively behind. Because it showed last game, they went behind. Yes, there was a little bit of a comeback, but they were just so far behind that even though that they were slowly coming back in this game, as they showed that their team fight presence was so good, it just really didn't matter because the goal lead wasn't in their favor. And the one thing I do notice is that Caitlyn, when she backed, did not pick up a BF sword. She actually went into the Berserker's Greaves instead, but because they got 6, they actually want this fight. The damage is coming through. Crestfallen doing so much. One more auto just wasn't enough. Ninjahawk just barely able to live through that, so just great aggression there coming out from Penn State, almost able to pick up a 2v2 kill down in the bot side, and Ninjahawk has to watch out. Caitlyn still has her ace in the hole, and without Zyra anywhere close to block that shot, that could have been a kill if that ultimate, the ace in the hole, was used at the perfect time. But now with the healing coming through, Ninjahawk is going to be fine. Not going to die in an all-in anytime soon, especially with this roam coming in. That's going to be a missed arrow right through the uprights as it just goes in between both of them, and they're not going to get too much here. But Light Turtle already here, pop the ghost. Nice flash coming out from Crestfallen. That is the trap. That is the CC lockdown as Sayonara comes in to pick up the kill, and Dubs with the great teleport on the backside is going to jump on to uLol, and that's going to be 2 kills. That's going to be Penn State going up 3-1 as we did see Junrei drop there, but that is so much in their favor. Guchen now up here going to jump on to Ninjahawk. Is it going to be enough damage? One more arrow should do it. That's going to be Sayonara jumping in to pick up that kill. The nice flash forward by Dubs. LC is a dog trying to do what he can to get away, but is forced to flash away. That is going to be now 4-1 in favor of Penn State. That's giving themselves a goal lead over 1,000. And this is going to give over the dragon as well. Great job by Penn State here to pick up the kills, go over and take the dragon, And it's just going to be really tough now for RU. They're the ones that now have to play behind. We'll have to see if they're going to be able to play differently than what RU did last time. Or, well, I guess Penn State did last time, where they just weren't able to come back. Maybe RU will be able to come back from this deficit. They still have all their towers left. And we saw last time how those towers really helped Penn State to get the early lead. RU might be able to do something different to get their lead this time around. Maybe they don't give over the towers. Maybe they get some towers themselves. Because I don't think Penn State got a single tower last game. So this gold lead actually being closed in a little bit as RU was still able to farm up packs to C4. Nice use of that steadfast presence to not allow Dubs to go in there. And this is just going to be back to the classic top lane fight. And the one that we see is Paxos C4 able to get quite a bit of a CS lead because of that roam bot lane. So granted though, Dubs was able to get his team so many kills, and Paxos C4 didn't teleport bot side actually, holding onto that teleport. So I wonder how much that fight would have been different if that Poppy did show up, because it was a very extended fight. That's something that I have to look back on. Like, was there a chance for Dubs to be interrupted? Was Paxos C4 very low and had a back? Not really sure. And in this mid lane, Light Turtle actually not bullying Gochan as much as I thought he was going to. Yes, there is a big CS lead, but Lice using that ultimate, the Chrono Shift, saving him from the Unleash the Power coming out from Light Turtle. So that ultimate just being completely canceled out. But as we said, that is still a 20 CS lead in favor of Light Turtle, even with no ultimate or not. That means now Gochan doesn't have his ultimate as well. So it is just an ultimate trade here. But Light Turtle still putting the pressure onto him. That Thunderlord is helping so much. Peter, though, going to get locked down, but the trap just not in time. So there won't be any extended CC there, but still, the sustain is going to help Penn State stay healthy in this matchup as they're playing very far ahead. They have, I really like the trap placement here, because if anything happens, they can just back off and the engage from RU is going to be cut back because they can't walk through the plants. So they're going to have to walk around them, and just that's enough time wasted that they're going to be able to get away. So still 700 gold lead going for Penn State, but they have 3 kills on RU. That's showing that these CS differences actually are mattering. Bot lane, it's only 8, doesn't really matter, but mid lane, it's around 30 right now. Top lane, it's around 10. So that is just helping that CS lead stay relatively close. And that was just because of the roam, mostly, and the fact that Syndra versus Echo isn't strongly in Syndra's favor. This I really do believe that the top lane farm difference is just because of the teleport bot. It allowed Paxos C4 to just push the tower, get a lot of tower damage, which he actually wasn't able to finish off the tower, but he at least was able to get CS in the process. And in the mid lane, it is just because of that mismatch. So Paxos C4 clearing out the wave pretty well, and actually, I think this is just trying to give LC as a dog a great place to come here, but here comes the CC lockdown. Peter Lull is going to be the target, but look at the damage coming in from Ninja Hawk. Can he finish this off? He's not going to be able to go 1v2 just yet. The heal is still available for Crestfallen, holding off to that, trying to bait Ninja Hawk, but is not able to find the damage in there. Sayonara is actually bot lane, but just completely bad. No, he's still there. So it looks like they're still trying to bait something here on the bot side, but looks like that Ninja Hawk isn't biting. So this fight is going to continue the top side. Paxos C4 dealing quite a bit of damage to that tower. We saw that from the teleport earlier, that Dubs came bot side to pick up those 3 kills that went in favor of Penn State. But that tower damage might be enough that Paxos C4 and maybe LC as a dog is going to show up top here as well to try to go and take down this tower, because that burst of gold is going to help them get back into this game. Even though it is only 800 in the side of Penn State, that's not really too massive. it might be enough that if a team fight breaks out, because we saw Penn State was winning those team fights around 15, 20 minutes when they were 5K behind. If they're just a little bit of ahead, it's going to allow them to do so much better. And Dubs is most likely going to have to use his teleport here into the top side to protect that tower, because if not, the tower is definitely going to go down. He is so now he's able to pick up this Sunfire Cape, so that's one big ticket item that he has already. Going to get a big power spike there, while Poppy actually not only finishing that, but also has the Spectre Cowl. All she doesn't have is any boots, while Maokai does have those Merc Treads already. So actually, we do see that Dubs didn't have to use the teleport, but that tower on the top side is not looking too good. As we go ahead to look at it, it is on its last little bit of health, so I don't really see how Dubs right here is actually not going to be able to teleport. Like, the one thing is, even though he has a teleport, he has to realize at this point that if I teleport and Pax's C4 does it, I am losing my tower 100%. And it's still first tower gold on the table, so even though it did get nerfed, that's still a big burst of gold you don't want to give over to your lane opponent. And yeah, this damage coming to the top side, not really too much going both ways. Poppy is actually getting the worst of it so far, and I think that's just the Sunfire Cape and the shields from Nautilus just not allowing him to take any damage, and just Poppy just taking that consistent burn over time. Back to C4, still going fairly aggressive. It is going to cost him a little bit of health, though. But he's just still applying the pressure. But this is just normal top lane things in this meta, that they could just throw abilities after abilities at each other. But it just really doesn't matter at this stage of the game. Sorry about that. So Pax of C4 here, still just trying to do something against Dubs here, but he is the one taking the majority of this damage. So I feel like Pax of C4 here, all he wants to do is go after the minions and just try to harass Dubs as much as he can. Actually, what he's doing is forcing Dubs to use that mana. We see him consistently riptiding just to deal with these minions as they're being shut to his tower. So as long as Pax of C4 is able to consistently do this, it does cost him a little bit of health each time, but look at the mana from Dubs being consistently drained. So I really like this pickup, and now here comes LC as a dog. Great use of the flash to get out of there, but he does misses the dredge line. So even though he didn't need that, he was still able to get out. So the only thing I think of is, I don't know if that flash was actually worth it. I feel like he could have just walked out and maybe used a dredge line a little more effectively, but he instantly flashed, didn't take any damage, allowing him to stay in the top side. And LC is a dog not staying up here. I feel like they could have pushed to get this tower, but this is going to be another Windrake going over to Penn State. I don't know why Directed Camera loves this top side so much, but it's probably because it's just the most action going on the map, as everybody else is just farming up as well. You see LC is a dog taking out his red buff, probably the mid lane again, just doing what mid lane things do, is just trying to poke each other out of lane. And we are going to see Echo being able to pick up a blue buff here. And we actually might have a roam up here. Pax of C4 might actually be ganked on, as we're seeing both Echo and Kha'Zix up here. But Dubs going a little too far forward, doesn't have the ultimate here. But here comes Sayonara. Great use in the Steadfast Presence as he's going to get knocked up. But it doesn't matter, as Gochan is up here as well. Sayonara picks up that one. He is 3-0-1 on this Kha'Zix so far. He is massive in this game. So this might actually get the pressure now to push this top side. They have to realize that they have to go for this tower right now, because if they don't, they're going to be the ones to lose first tower. So I feel like Penn State needs to try to rush this tower down. No one from RU is going to be able to defend it, but they're not going to be able to kill it in time, as RU's already was in the mid lane. They took their tower, and now because they didn't back, I was actually wrong. They shouldn't have gone for it, because now we see that RU is consistently going for that. They could have went for a tier 2, and now Penn State's bot lane has to worry that this roam coming up, they're no longer mid. They're not going for that tower anymore. They're going to get a red buff steal, but because Penn State saw what was going on, they aren't going to lose their bot lane. And just tower trades right now, First Blood did go over to RU, but it's still 1,000 gold lead going over to Penn State. So the gold leads, the CS leads, we were saying, kind of stagnated. Paxa C4 actually increasing his CS lead. It was around 10 earlier, now it's around 30. While it was 30 in the mid lane for a while, it's actually staying around that. So great use of Gochan there to use that champion to stay even with Light Turtle there. But Paxa C4, we saw that turtle or that tower trade. But the thing that they have to worry about is that he's going to get that top tower eventually. It is so low right now on about 300-400 health. So if Dubs ever leaves his top lane, that is an easy tower for RU. And that means the game will be back even. Now, Penn State does have these Windrakes, so they are going to be able to rotate very quickly. And that's something that RU does have to realize, that when Penn State does roam, they're going to get to their moments a lot faster than you would think that they're going to be. But yeah, Pax C4, Dubs, we've seen this all game, just doing average top laner stuff. And with three people bot side for RU, they might be trying to gank on to Gochan here. But yeah, nothing too special. Neither of the junglers are showing themselves. Nothing's really going to be happening at this point. Penn State just going to try to slowly increase their lead. It is now still over 1,000. It hasn't changed too much since the beginning of the game. But I stated a couple times today, Penn State showed that they were able to win the fights when they were behind, massively behind too. So we'll have to see if once the team fights actually start of how much they're going to win. But as this game goes longer and longer, that 1,000 gold lead's not going to mean as much. So Penn State able to get an early lead, just not able to increase it. And Gochan just gets completely caught out. Nice use of the arrow there. Great just strategy coming out from RU. Bush strats coming in, going to give them over a kill, and this is just going to give them pressure here to go for this inhibitor, or this, the tower there, and Penn State has to try something at this point. Sayonara is going to be on the top side, going to go on to Paxa C4, gets a slow in, but the flash going to come from Paxa C4, actually no, gets locked down, the flash still not being used, the ultimate being interrupted, and Dubs picking up a kill on the top side, so they lose a tower bot, they lose a member, but they are at least able to trade it, but their tier 2s are going to be, being chunked down right now, as with this rotation actually favoring RU. Turret trade and one damage. They might actually get a tier 2 with this, but Penn State, this might be a fight they won. They actually, if they could find the engage, could work out for them, but that tower is going to drop, so a tier 2 going in favor of RU, so giving themselves the gold lead. RU having better rotations right here. Can Penn State find the collapse right now? Dubs did teleport to the bot side, so if he's able to lock them down, this could go in favor of Penn State. They need to try something right here. RU just trying desperately to go for this tower damage as well. They're being locked down here. The dredge line not going to land, but LC is a dog being locked down. Gochan not able to find the damage. Can he find the ultimate back? He can, but he's still fairly low, as that is going to be a rampage going over Sinar. Finds the kills and finds the resets to get out. Now Crestfallen's here as well. Dubs picks up a kill. He's on a killing spree right now as the fight does continue. Ninjahawk does trade one, but that's still going to be 3-4-1 at this point. LC's dog somehow find his way alive, but Paxa C4 teleporting down here. Probably shouldn't have, because he's going to be chucked down. Does get a consolation prize of the Nami, but all in all, that's a 4-2 advantage. Advantage going over to Penn State. Penn State there finding the collapse. Dubs there with a nice teleport and just able with that Windrake to get into positioning and allow. And this was the usage of that Windrake. Without that Windrake, RU could have probably got out of there, but they were able to close in on them. They collapse around them. Top lane is pushing in their favor, so their top lane tower doesn't go down. Paxa C4 had a very late TP, and it was in the middle of everything, so he went down almost immediately. He was only able to find a trade kill on the Nami, but that was probably not worth it. But all in all, RU, they got that tier 2. That's going to help them. But they're still behind. 10-4 in kills, about 1,000 in gold, a little bit less, so they had to hope that this gold lead stays relatively the same, so that when these fights happen, it helps them out and the gold stays the same. Because I feel like the one reason why Penn State won that fight was just because of positioning was amazing. The collapse was great. Gochan there being cut out yet again, though. Forcing to use the ultimate, but it was a point-blank ultimate. Here comes the arrow. Not going to land, though. Nice sidestep from the Echo. But this might be the re-engage coming in from Penn State. But Crestfallen going to be jumped on. Not able to jump over the wall because of the steadfast presence. But Paxa C4 so tanky, but is going to be down to half health. But the front line for Penn State is going to drop as Dubs goes down as well as Gochan. So that's 0-2-0 trade so far as June gets caught up as well. This is going to go in favor of RU as they're able to find a couple kills and they're making their way to the Baron. This is huge for RU. Ryerson here now going after the Baron. This might be a little too aggressive. Death timers are still fairly short, but at 20 seconds, it is going to be long enough. Sayonara has to go for a Desperation Steal if he wants this, but he's not going to. So even though RU was behind for the majority of this game, they are now going to get Baron. They are now going to go behind ahead now. So great team fight there coming out from Ryerson. And now Penn State, again, is going to have to play on their back foot. And the thing is, Penn State wasn't able to get anything off of that. There was no there's a Dragon's Egg, so they were able to get an Infernal Drake off of that. So Sayonara at least got something for that Baron. They have three Drakes for them, so this is going to have to be them getting to the late game, letting that Infernal Drake stack up, letting those Wind Drakes allow them to out-rotate RU, but they are the ones that got caught out in that last fight. This all started on Gochan getting caught in the mid lane, forcing him to use that ultimate. He didn't really go anywhere with it. It was almost a point-blank ultimate. All it did was give him more health, so that when that fight broke out, the Echo was extremely low. Dubs just got chunked down because he was all alone. We're going to see Pax's C4 getting locked down by everything out of this. This might actually be the Poppy getting caught out, just barely able to live, but Dubs is going to go down as light. Turtle picks up a kill for himself. The Ash Arrow going to miss, but Pax's C4 able to survive, is going to be able to back out with that advanced recall too. So Ryerson here going to be able to get a kill and another tower in their favor. The goal lead was around 1,000 for Penn State for the majority of the game, but now with this huge swing, it's around 4,000 for Ryerson. And now they're just going to rotate to the bot side. They already have packs of C4 here trying to push out that minion wave so they can get this. And it is the last inner tower remaining. And after that, it's just inhibitor towers. And I feel like they're just going to go for the easy towers. They're not going to try to do anything too desperate. They're not going to overextend, get caught, and give Penn State any way to come back in this game. They're playing it smart. They're playing it slowly. And once they're able to take these towers, it's just going to be really tough. Penn State has to now fight from a 5K deficit yet again. Last time, they were able to win some fights, but this time around, Ryerson was the one winning with a deficit. Granted, it was only 1,000, but they were the ones winning this time around. Now, the minions are finally there, and there's a lot of minions, too. And now with four members, actually, here of Ryerson, they're going to be able to easily take this last inner tower. So that's six towers now for Ryerson. All that's left is the hard-to-take inhibitor towers, and it's just going to be harder and harder for Penn State to defend. But Ryerson now just dancing around Dragon, not going to spawn for quite a while yet, so they don't really have anything on the map to take. It's only 28 minutes in the game here, and they have all towers gone and no objectives on the map. That's pretty early for that to happen. So Light Turtle doing an amazing work in this game so far. LC a dog again, having extremely high kill participation. 7 out of 8, that's around 80%. Some percent, I'm not 100% sure what it is, but it is really high right now. And now, as Ryerson tries to push up every lane right now, the Baron buff is going to go out relatively soon, but that's going to be Gojang being cut out. But with the heals coming in and the speed ups, he's going to be fine. And this is all in all, let's see, 5K in favor of Ryerson. Just really tough now for Penn State. They've done it before. Let's see if they can do it again. But even last time when they won those fights, they just weren't able to get the advantage their way. Now they have some tower gold this time around. It is 2 towers to 6, but Ryerson playing on the back foot, just able to get themselves that gold lead. And I feel like they're just trying to throw in the minion waves. They're doing a 1-4 split push right here with Poppy in the top side, just pushing the minion waves in. And if they continue this, we'll see the tower damage go little by little until they're actually able to pull the trigger and go in on it. And this forces Dubs up there, so that's a huge frontliner now, not there for Penn State, as RU is going to be able to continue to push these minion waves. And this now forces Caitlyn to be in a vulnerable position. If she goes too far forward to wave clear, they're going to be able to engage, and Dubs is going to take a little bit of time to get up here because he has to deal with those minions top lane. Junior was able to find a bubble, but not going to be able to do too much just yet because he was all alone. And all of these traps and plants in the mid lane are actually fairly confusing looking to see what you can step on, what you can't from each team. And yeah, that's going to be June just getting rid of all those plants to clean it up a little bit there in the mid lane as we see RU rotate closer to this dragon. Not sure what it is. It's going to be another Windrake, so they aren't going to give over a third Windrake. Because of that, Pax's C4 is all alone. Actually going to miss that hammer, too. So he's trying to get the trade on, but it's not going to be enough. That's going to be Sayonara jumping forward. They do pick up the dragon, but they lose their top laner in the process. So Penn State with a nice trade there going to help them. But losing a top laner for a jungle, for a dragon, not too bad. So now this is going to slow down what Ryerson wants to do. They can no longer go for the split push. They really can't go for the siege anymore. So they have to just try to clear up their jungle, try to push out the waves as much as they can. But because it'll be a 5v4 for the next 25 seconds, they're not really able to do too much. And this is allowing Penn State to get that Baron vision that they desperately need at this point in the game. And they actually aren't putting too much vision down. They were trying to siege in the mid lane, just weren't able to go against Light Turtle and Peter there, though. So we're going to see them not really get too much on this map. I would hope to see them get a little bit more vision down, especially with that Rift Herald still alive. I would love to see them go and get that right now. So as this game moves on, both the junglers having such a high impact. Neither of them have died right now. 4-0-4 on the Kha'Zix's, 2-0-5 on the Graves. They've just been massive in this game so far. And really, it seems like this is a battle between mid lane and bot lane as well. We see Caitlyn doing a lot better than the Ashe. We're also seeing the Syndra doing a lot better than the Echo. And as this game goes on, it's like, what is going to have the bigger impact? So Penn State able to get this Rift Herald might dissuade RU from getting this dragon a little bit. But with these five strong right here, it seems like they're just going to go for it. Yeah, they're starting up immediately, and we'll have to see how Penn State interacts with his Baron attempt here, because we still see that Gochan is in the bot side, and Dub's going to get locked down by that arrow, but he is taking enough to survive. The ultimate's going to come in through Syndra, but Crestfallen is going to be able to survive. This might actually go in Penn State's favor. Sayonara trying to find the... That's going to be Echo coming in. The kills are going to come in, actually. It's 2-for-1 for Penn State already. And can they continue on this? But no. Look at LC's a dog doing so much in this fight. Crestfallen trying to do what he can. Can he find the kills? He's being jumped on by Pax of C4. He is able to find that. That is going to be everybody but LC dog dropping for RU. And that's going to go in Penn State's favor. This might be a little too dangerous, though. The Graves is still alive. The Flash is gone, but they still have that blast code. I don't know if they could go for this. They're attempting it, though. They're backing off. Okay. So with LC is a dog living, they're not going to be able to go for it. But all in all, that went in favor of Penn State. They stopped the Baron attempt. A nice teleport and a nice gank there by Gochan, actually, with the collapse to find the kills in the backside. Actually turned that fight in Penn State's favor. The thing that did go for RU, they chunked down Crestfallen so low, is that he really didn't have an impact in that fight right away because he was forced to back off. He couldn't come in because he was so low. Then once that happened, RU was able to find the kills. Crestfallen came back in to clean up, but because he wasn't there throughout the entire fight, RU almost won that. And now we're seeing pings on the Baron right now, just hoping to get some sort of vision right here. Now, Penn State is the one controlling the vision around the Baron, so all that fight really did was give Penn State the advantage here around the Baron. But still being 5k behind, they're really not going to be able to force their way in here. And that would have been Sayonara caught up if it wasn't for his leap. So he's able to jump over that wall and keep himself alive for now. But it is going to cost their own vision here in this Baron pit. And just looking at the evolves for Sayonara, it looks like he went with the QWE, the very, very standard in this stage of the game. Not a lot of people go for that ultimate at all, really, anymore. It's just not as good as the others. And we're going to see that W, it has a massive slow when they're isolated, so you want that. Your Q range goes up and the damage goes up and the cooldown goes down when you evolve that, so you definitely want that. You want the leap because it's longer and you want... the resets, so that's one you want. And The ultimate is just kind of cool. Whenever you go bushes, you get invisibility. When you get a third proc of it as well. But it's just not as good as the other ones. But Sayonara gonna get caught out. He's forced to run the wrong way as Elsie is a dog. Is gonna be able to pick that one up. Great use of the Zonius to keep Light Turtle alive. So this could be huge now for RU as Penn State is gonna be missing their jungler. Not sure why he was there. Shouldn't have gotten caught out there, but Crestfalling able to deal quite a bit of damage over to RU. They don't have the Ocean Drake like game one, so they don't have the regen at this point. But this is still a 3v4 in their favor. But they have to watch out. Ninja Hawk is extremely low. They are going to start this Baron, it looks like. But in the meantime, the mid tower finally goes down. And here comes Gochan coming in for this. But the Baron already at half health. This might be the fight they want as the bot side fight continues here. But here is the Baron. It's going so low. That might be in favor of RU. They do pick up the Baron. There is no steal attempt. So it's really nothing going over in Penn State. They weren't able to find the damage as actually June did get caught out there and did go down. So they couldn't go in because it would have been a 2v4 and it wouldn't have worked for them. Dubs and Paxi C4 just doing top laner things down here. Not really doing too much to each other. But because of this, we see in the top side they're going to be pushing down for this. And they're going to go for this tower. But bot side, they're going to collapse onto Paxi C4. This might cost their inhibitor towers, though, as Paxi C4 doesn't trade a kill. That's Crestfallen dominating. But yes, this is going to cost them an inhibitor. I don't know if this was worth it for Penn State. They lose an inhibitor. They do get a kill for themselves, but this is now super minions going into their base. This is just wasn't a good decision out of Penn State there. They lost too much on that. Now 7k gold lead in favor of RU, sorry, and they still have the Baron buff and they are going for this Elder Drake, which is going to really help them because now it hurts Penn State because they have three Drakes right now. They really want this Elder Drake. It's going to really help them, and Sire and Nara are going to have to go for a lucky steal, it seems like, because we are going to see them just clear out minions or wards. They are not going to go for the dragon. As I say that, they are going to proc it and probably go for it. They're just going to drag it out. So this is going to make it really tough for Sayonara to go in for this steal, because if he wants to go for it, he's going to have to leap and flash to get in range. And we see them try to get in here. The teleport's going to come through, but that is going to be the dragon picked up by RU. I don't think Penn State wants this fight, but Light Turtle gets counted out. They take him out. That's a mid laner gone for RU. This actually could go in the favor of Penn State if they could find the final kills. Can they find it? Sayonara picks another kill on Peter Lowell. He has the resets. Can he get them? He gets another reset. No, Elsie as a dog doesn't drop. He gets a double kill instead. But Gochan there is going to be in there. That's four dead on the side of RU and only two on Penn State. Paxis C4 is the last one alive, and he can't find the kills. The shield comes through. That's a triple kill for the Echo and an ace for Penn State. They don't get the Elder Drake, but they get the kills, and that's every single buff now gone for RU. Penn State's going to push up the mid lane and hopefully get some towers to even out this gold lead. Penn State now pushing up this mid lane. They want to get some sort of gold in their favor. They have to watch out for that minion wave pushing in the top lane, and they're not pushing enough because they're a little bit scared of Light Turtle and Peter Lull, who are respawning very shortly. They don't want to overextend, so they're not going to be able to get that inhibitor tower. But with getting that one tier 2 tower, they will at least be able to get some gold in their pocket. It is going to be a 6,000 gold lead still in the favor of RU, but Penn State not out of it just yet. So now RU and Penn State now dancing around this topside jungle. Really nothing going to happen too much because there's no objectives on the map for RU unless they want to try to do a split push of continually pushing those super minions up topside while the rest of the team push bot to go for that tower. But we do see the Echo Guchan there pushing it up, so it not allowing RU to do that split push. If it does, they have to start setting it up because the minion wave bot side is in favor of Penn State. The minion wave mid is kind of in favor of RU being pushed forward. But with a lot of people there, not really going to go for it just yet. Sayonara here, though, has to watch out. But Pyle pass to C4 is actually a little bit along the slow from the evolved W is going to really help out. But that's forcing the ultimate away from Sayonara. He wasn't able to leap because of the steadfast presence. So great job by Pax to C4. As I say that, he takes quite a bit of harass. And Crestfallen here actually now has that GA, so he's going to stay alive. It does take away some of the damage, but he's still going to be able to just throw out so much in these fights. We're seeing Pax to C4 being chunked down so low with this double zeal, as well as that IE. It's just going to do so much for him. These headshots are already doing so much damage, and Penn State is able to defend their mid tower right now. And RU right here, without any objectives on the map, red buff is spawning, but that's basically it. They're just trying to siege their way, and I feel like if they want to do this, they should go for bot instead. The top wave is going to push for them because there's super minions in it. So going for mid, it's a very easy rotation, especially with double Windrake. They just have to very slightly change direction. But if you go from top to bot, that's quite of a ways away. But the minion wave is just not in their favor, so they're just trying to push with the minion wave that they did have instead of trying to set up the one bot side. But yeah, this gold lead, as this game goes on, 40 minutes in, their inhibitor back up as well. Penn State is clawing their way back in this game. They had the early lead. They gave it away a little bit when RU just got a big burst of gold to take the gold lead. But Penn State is staying in this. With that inhibitor now back up, they're going to be able to actually do stuff off the map. They don't have to worry about the super minions just flooding into their base. And this is allowing them to give time to put down some vision around Baron, because this will be another big fight for either team. I believe this will be the third Baron pickup, with RU getting two of them so far. So we'll have to see if RU gets their third Baron, but Sayonara here hoping to get someone caught out. It is going to be LC Dog, but the rest of his team is still there. The slow coming from the Void Spikes going to hurt just a little bit, but without any engage coming in, it really didn't matter all too much. We see the teams now dancing around this Baron pit, wanting to get the vision on to their favor, but the Baron's not spawned for another 20 seconds, so we won't see any rush coming out anytime soon for RU. But they just want to push in for this inhibitor, it seems. They weren't able to get the tower, but we do see Dubs is still extremely far forward. The ultimate going to come through is going to miss Gochan. So that is now an Ash Arrow going to be down. We're seeing Dubs now finally backing, but will be too late as RU is going to continue this siege. They're going to go for this inhibitor. The teleport from the backside. I'm really liking this coming out from Penn State. This might be the collapse that they need, as well as Nami there. Gochan goes in, but he just doesn't go down in time. Actually, the GA is going to be popped, but here comes the ultimate. Dom's doing so much in the backside, but where is the rest of the team for Penn State? Gochan comes back in. The ultimate coming in from Light Turtle, but it's not enough. The damage is on to Crestfallen as he's all alone. The GA not going to matter too much as he drops. Just not enough damage from Penn State as RU survives, and they're continuing this siege. It was just a 1-for-0 trade in favor of Penn State, or in favor of RU, and because of that, they take Penn State's inhibitor, and now they're looking at the Baron. Such a hectic fight there. We saw Dubs and Nami both try to flank there, and even though Dubs did go in there, Nami wasn't there to peel for the AD carry. Crestfallen getting caught out, wasn't able to do too much, blew both summoner spells and the GA and still died, so that's pretty massive. But Sayonara trying for the steal. Can he get in there? The bubble not going to land, but here comes another teleport for the Echo. Can they go for it? It's about 1,000 gold, but the red team still picks up the Baron, but can Penn State win the fight? The kills are going to be 1-for-1, 2-for-1 actually so far in the favor of Penn State, but that's going to be another kill. Penn State's dropping like flies here as Dubs and Sayonara, the last two alive. That's going to be another GA popped, and that is going to be an ace coming up once they kill Dubs. He's the last one alive for Penn State. And actually, it won't be an ace as... Oh no, it did just in time. Crestfallen did respawn, but just a little bit of an overextension there. I think Sayonara should have went for the Baron instead of going for the kills. Because of that, RU got the Baron and then got the kills. And now they are now going to just siege in the mid lane. They already have the minions on their side, and it's just Crestfallen all by himself. I don't think he could defend this. He's trying his hardest, but that's just Pax of C4 being so tanky. And LC Dog going to go for that is going to be a dead Caitlyn. Not able to get the trade kill. Another ace going in favor of RU. And with a death timer so high, still 10 more seconds. They're just going to go for the win. This could be it. Penn State not going to be alive in time. Are you going to move on from round one of the playoffs? And Penn State's going to be eliminated in the first round. And that's going to be Ryerson moving on. Fantastic game from both sides, though. Those fights did go both ways in that mid and late game, but Ryerson there, they were able to play with that 1,000 gold deficit and turning it into a 5,000 gold lead really worked for them. And it was just Penn State just, they were able to get that early lead, but they just weren't able to do anything with it. They weren't able to extend it. They weren't able to get any towers. But Ryerson, once they were able to take any sort of advantage, they were able to take that and just snowball their goal lead. And that was just one thing that Penn State just wasn't able to do. So Ryerson played amazing in this game. And again, that was just LC Dog 9-1-9. He is my player of the match right now. He played amazing in both games, having extremely high kill participation too. I think this one, let's see, he had about a 95%, no, it'd be a 90%. So all in all, he had above a 90% kill participation throughout both games. That is just massive in these games. So just great job to Ryerson, and I'm really excited to see of how far they go into the CSL finals. So thank you to both teams for allowing me to cast for you guys today. Let's go ahead and check to see what the damage on the champions were. Caitlyn doing quite a bit, but just wasn't enough. So, Ryerson, good luck with the rest of the playoffs. And, hey, if you want me to cast your games, just let me know. I'm always up to casting a lot of games. So, thank you so much for allowing me to cast this game. Penn State, you played valiantly. Just were sadly knocked out of this. The second game, though, was extremely close. Could have went both ways. But Ryerson just played a little bit better today. So, thank you, everybody who are watching. Thank you, everybody who followed. Thank you, everybody who's already following. I really appreciate it. Now, one thing to keep in mind, if you guys wanted to see more games, in about 4.5 hours, I'll be casting a BTN matchup today. I forget who the two teams are, but it is going to be the final game. So this could mean that one of the teams are either not going to make playoffs or make playoffs. So it is going to be a huge game tonight. So make sure to be back for that. And yeah, I'll see you guys later tonight.